Hi guys, class 7, how are you doing? I hope you had a great weekend and you had spent time with your mother also during it was Mother's Day and you got great quality time to spend time with your mom and your family as well. So I just want to say that you are still keeping safe and you are keeping at home and you are taking care of yourselves, guys. That's really great. And I just want to go through with this history chapter which we were through, like at this part we were with this new kings and kingdoms. I'll just read through today and I'll do the reading. I have put up many PDF files there with question and answers on your download tab where you can just see and start solve. I have given some answers as well too. So we'll just do the reading today. You study it yourself. On the next class on Thursday, I'm going to come with some explanations. Okay, so let's do this today. Like, see, there are the new kings and kingdoms. I had told you in the last class also that there was a disturbance between all of them. There was a three, the Rashtrakutas, the Palas and the Rajputs, the Gurjaras, the Pratiharas and the Cholas. So these had this problem within themselves, but they slowly their dynasties and the kingdoms started to fall down. I had explained to you this already, but I'll just go through again. I'll just read a portion and it might not match with your book because I don't have a book. So I'm just reading from the notes which I have made myself. So I'm going to send it over to you. I've already sent it. You can check it once again. So I'll start. Many dynasties emerged after the 7th century. Okay. So the notes which is there with you, there's going to be a map also. So I'm just reading out the shows the map also shows the major ruling dynasties in different parts of the subcontinent between the 7th and the 12th centuries. Okay, so you have to follow the map which is there in the book. The emergence of the new dynasties, what were there? What were they actually happening? By the 7th century, there were big landlords or warrior chiefs in different regions of the subcontinent. Existing kings often acknowledged them as their subordinates or samantas. They were expected to bring gifts for their kings or overlords, be present at their courts and provide them with military support. The samantas gained power and wealth. They declared themselves as the Mahasamanta, the Mahamandaleshwara, the great lord of a circle or region. Okay, and so on. Sometimes they asserted their independence from their overlords. So the samantas, who were the samantas? They were big landlords, you know. They had the power, they had the money, and they were in the king's court, and they tried to build in themselves, they availed a place for themselves as the Mahasamantas. One such instance was that of the Rashtrakutas in the Deccan. Initially the Rashtrakutas, they were the subordinate of the Chalukyas of Karnataka. In the mid 8th century, Danti Durga, and a Rashtrakuta chief, overthrew his Chalukya overlord and performed a ritual called Hiranya Garbha, literally the golden womb. When this ritual was performed with the help of Brahmanas, it was thought to lead to the rebirth of the sacrificer as a Kshatriya, even if he was not one by birth. Even if he was not born of a Kshatriya family, he was being renowned as a Kshatriya because they had done this, that performed this ritual. Okay, in other cases, men from enterprising families used their family their military skills to carve out kingdoms. For instance, the Kadamba, Mayushashram and the Gurjara, Pratihara, Harichandra were Brahmins who gave up their traditional professions and took to arms, successfully establishing kingdoms in Karnataka and Rajasthan respectively. So we are going to keep it till here only, or we can just go, I'll just go a little bit more so that in the next class I'll be able to make a notes for you and explain it to you in the most easiest words which is going to be possible. So many of these new kings adopted high sounding tiles many of these new kings adopted high sounding titles such as Maharaja, Dhiraja, Great King, Overlord of Kings, Tribhuvana, Chakravartin, Lord of Three Worlds, and so on. However, in spite of such claims, they often shared power with their samantas as well as with associations of peasants, traders and brahmanas. In each state, resource were obtained from the producers, that is peasants and cattle keepers, artisans who were persuaded or compelled to surrender part of what they produced. Sometimes they were claimed as a rent due to a lord who asserted their own land. Revenue was also collected from traders. So this is the basic information about the kingdoms which were happening there and what was happening there. Now the 400 taxes, we have done this earlier also. The inscription of the Cholas who ruled in Tamil Nadu referred to more than 400 terms of different kind of taxes. The most frequently mentioned tax is vetti, taken not in cash but in form or of forced labor, and kadamai or land revenue. There were also taxes on thatching the house, the use of a ladder to climb palm trees, assess on succession to family property. Various type of taxes were there. Okay, so we are going to keep it till here today. You are going to study properly and see the notes which I have given you. I am going to take it very slowly. We will not take pressure in it. The next class, what I am going to do is I am going to start with the Palas. What did the Palas do? How did they come into action and how did they settle their kingdoms and what happened? What were the reasons for their downfall? The main reasons for the downfall of these new kingdoms where they were fighting between themselves. Okay, and after this only the Sultanate started coming in. This is the general idea of it. So you have to study, take care of the notes, write it down properly and make sure you do your informations properly about it. Okay, so I'll just come back in the next video. Okay.